Welcome to church on this beautiful Sunday morning. It is good to be here with you. I was just calculating how long it had been since I'd stood in this pulpit. It's been like 3 weeks. Yeah, kind of worried if anybody would show up. Oh, John's back. Never mind. Ain't going this morning. But I'm glad y'all are here this morning and have gathered together to worship. I will bring your attention to a number of announcements this morning. First, next Sunday, October 2nd, that's hard to believe that October is here. It'll be Christmas before we know it. But next Sunday, October 2nd, we will observe our quarterly service of the Lord's Supper during morning worship, as well as collect our benevolence offering at the close of service. Coming up on Sunday, October 16th, will be our 30th anniversary service. And I hope that you have already made plans to attend and come and help us celebrate. I'm asking members of our church family to come and share their Horizon story during worship that morning, what Horizon has meant to you, why it's been an important part of your life, why you choose to worship here, however you may feel led. But please let me know ahead of time that you would like to participate so we can plan the service around that. But it will be a time of reflecting on Horizon's history and dreaming about her future. And I do believe it will be a wonderful time of worship. And yes, we will be eating that Sunday as well. So make plans accordingly for that as well. Coming up on October 9th, the budget committee will meet at 2 o'clock. So if you were on the budget committee, I hope that you've already got that on your calendar. And last but certainly not least, we continue to collect supplies for the animal shelter, as well as in need of volunteers who could run those supplies over there. So if you are willing to do that, or you have some supplies that you would like to donate, please remember you can continue to do so. But again, I'm glad that you were here this morning. May we worship together.
Please stand as we sing together the first two stanzas of our opening hymn, number 614, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart.
Since Jesus came into my heart. Good morning. Have y'all ever seen a mustard seed? Yeah, is it big or small? It's pretty tiny. A mustard seed. Pretty small seed. Now, some people, when they think of a mustard seed, they think of faith. And that is because of something Jesus said in Luke 17, 5 through 10. He says, when Jesus asked his friends, when his friends asked him how they could have a stronger faith, Jesus said, if you have faith even as small as a mustard seed, you can say to a mulberry tree, may you be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Jesus was saying that God is so powerful that our faith, even if it's small as a tiny seed, God can do incredible things. Now, he didn't say this just so that we can go and tell a tree to go move into the sea, right? That's not the point. His point was that even if we had a tiny bit of faith, God can do so much. And it's not about us. It's about God's power, right? So having faith that God can do amazing things through us, right? So this week, I want you to remember that even if you have a tiny faith, as small as a mustard seed, just a little bit of faith, God can do amazing things through y'all. All right, let's pray. God, we pray right now that we have faith in you, and even if it's just as small as a mustard seed, that you will do amazing things through all of us. In your name we pray. Amen.
You may remain seated for our next hymn, Jesus is All the World to Me. Thank you.
O Lord, you have lift us up and have blessed us with your ministry of this church. We thank you for our pastors, our elders, and teachers who nurture us spiritually. We thank you for each member who uses their spiritual gift to bless others. We thank you for the rich fellowship we enjoy with each other and corporately with you. We give our tithes and offerings to you now to support the ministry of this church in our community and worldwide. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand for the doxology.
Kids can head out to Children's Church. And the rest of us will turn our attention to reading what may at some point this morning feel like the entire Bible. We're going to start in Acts 13 this morning, in chapter 13, verse 16, and we are going to read through the end of chapter 13. So Paul stood up and with a gesture began to speak. You Israelites and the others who fear God, listen. The God of this people Israel chose our ancestors and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt. And with uplifted arm he led them out of it. And for about 40 years he put up with them in the wilderness. After he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he gave them their land as an inheritance for about 450 years. After that, he gave them judges until the time of the prophet Samuel. Then they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, who reigned for 40 years. When he had removed him, he made David their king. And in his testimony about him, he said, I have found David, son of Jesse, to be a man after my own heart, who will carry out all my wishes. And of this man's posterity, God has brought Israel a Savior, Jesus, as he promised. Before his coming, John had already proclaimed a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. And as John was finishing his work, he said, what do you suppose that I am? I am not he. No. But one is coming after me, and I am not worthy to untie the thong of the sandals on his feet. My brothers, you descendants of Abraham's family and others who fear God, to use the message of this salvation has been sent. Because the residents of Jerusalem and their leaders did not recognize him or understand the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. They fulfilled those words by condemning him. Even though they found no cause for a sentence of death, they asked Pilate to have him killed. When they had carried out everything that was written about him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, and they are now his witnesses to the people. And we bring you the good news that what God has promised to our ancestors, he has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising Jesus. As also, as it is written in the second psalm, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. As to his raising him from the dead, no more to return to corruption, he has spoken in this way. I will give you the holy promises made to David. Therefore, he has also said in another psalm, you will not let your Holy One experience corruption. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, died and was laid beside his ancestors and experienced corruption. But he whom God raised up experienced no corruption. So let it be known to you, therefore, my brothers, that through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. By this Jesus, everyone who believes is set free from all those sins from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. Beware, therefore, that what the prophets said does not happen to you. Look then, you scoffers, be amazed and perish, for in your days I am doing a work that you will never believe, even if someone tells you. Then, as Paul and Barnabas were going out, the people urged them to speak about these things again the next Sabbath. And when the meeting of the synagogue broke up, many Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who spoke to them and urged them to continue in the grace of God. The next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. But when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy. And blaspheming, they contradicted what was spoken by Paul. Then both Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying, "It was necessary that the word of God should be spoken first to you. But since you rejected and judge yourselves to be unworthy of eternal life, we are now turning to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, 'I have set you to be a light for the Gentiles, so that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth.'" When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and praised the word of the Lord. And as many as had been destined for eternal life became believers. Thus the word of the Lord spread throughout the region. But the Jews incited the devout women of high standing and the leading men of the city and stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their region. So they shook the dust off their feet in protest against them and went on to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. As we have journeyed through the book of Acts this summer and into the fall, as we have gone through the first 12 chapters of Acts, we saw how it is an account of how God moved among the people in the earliest days of the church. And now at chapter 13, the book begins to transition into the second part of the story, where we see what happened in these earliest decades of ministry. We see how things are changing in the cities and in the communities and in the world at large as a direct result of God moving among his disciples. Often when we think of the Apostle Paul and his companion Barnabas, we think of their missionary trips. We think of how they crisscrossed the Mediterranean world, preaching the gospel to anyone and everyone who would listen. But that's not the primary purpose of the book of Acts. It's not a travel blog, despite the fact that it covers a lot of travel. But rather, the focus of the book is on the acts of the disciples and the acts of the Spirit and how Jesus changes things wherever the message of salvation is brought. We see that the Holy Spirit brings them to various cities to preach the gospel to the people, to evangelize the people, to show them that Jesus can, in fact, change their life. And what we see is that the gospel does change things. Jesus changes things. It begins to change the region. And as we know, the message of the gospel changed the course of world history. And from this point forward in the book of Acts, Paul and Barnabas become kind of central characters of the story. But the changes that come are the work of Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Paul and Barnabas are simply the messengers. It's Jesus that changes things. On the one hand, Jesus is changing and challenging the way of the Roman Empire and the way that the world works from a socio-political standpoint. On the other hand, Jesus is changing things from a spiritual standpoint, challenging the Jewish leadership and the status quo. Anything and everything in their world as they had once knew it is now being changed by the message of the gospel. And Jesus is changing both the recipients and the messengers. We've seen Saul assume a new role and become Paul, the great missionary. We see the Gentiles now more fully be welcomed into the life of the church and the mission of God. In our episode that we read today, in particular, we found Paul and Barnabas in Antioch, which is in modern-day Turkey. And they come into the synagogue and they sit down together. And the keeper of the temple comes up to them and says, "Hey, you guys got anything you want to say?" And that's not out of the ordinary. In the ancient synagogue, most of the worship services were often very lay-centric. People could get up and read scripture and talk about what it meant to them, and kind of a testimony was a big part of synagogue worship. So Paul and Barnabas are invited to share what's on their heart. And oftentimes the synagogue could even be a lively place. If someone shared something that was on their heart that may not sit well with someone sitting in the congregation, the synagogue could also become a place for lively debate over the scriptures. So it would have been a natural gathering place for people to come and learn and worship and grow together. So it makes sense that this is where Paul and Barnabas would be. And so Paul says, "Absolutely, I would love to stand up and say a few things." And Paul takes the opportunity to lay out the gospel in a very clear and concise sermon. And the sermon is the meat and the potatoes of the passage that we've read this morning. And we're going to look at Paul's sermon in depth here. But the first thing I want you to notice is it says he used a gesture. Now, I'm not sure if I'm getting exactly right, but in ancient Greek, Greco-Roman culture, hand gestures when speaking were a big deal, and they all meant different things. And I looked them up, and my best guess to which one Paul was using was this one. You know, we might think of it as finger guns, pew, pew. And Paul was getting ready to kind of drop some knowledge on them. But this gesture means what I'm about to say is important. Pay attention to it. This is teaching. This is to be listened to. This is to be given serious thought. So Paul readies them before he even gets up to preach that what they are going to hear is going to challenge them. He's going to offer them instruction. He's going to offer them an opportunity to think differently, to perhaps change their life. And then he preaches a one-point sermon. In modern sermons, we often joke, but in practice we do it pretty regularly, but we joke that we often have 3 points in a poem, especially in Baptist life. But in ancient speech, they didn't do this. They had one, maybe 2 points that's the central thesis of their focus, and the whole speech or sermon or public address is all built around that one point. And that's how Paul preaches here. But let's break down his sermon. a little bit of an expository look at it. I don't do a lot of verse-by-verse expository preaching, but Paul's sermon is worth looking at that way for sure. Verse 16 is his introduction. He infers in his introduction who he's preaching to, who is there to listen to him. And what we can pick up from that is that he's got Jews and Gentiles in the audience. He's got both Jews and what he calls God-fearers, which would have been the people we might would describe as spiritually curious or spiritual but not religious. They believe in God. They fear God. They believe in the existence of a God. But they're unsure what they do with that. They don't know how to follow God or serve God. They believe in the idea of God. And they're there to trying to figure out, okay, is this what we need to be doing? And a lot of these God-fearers would go on to become Christians. And pre-Christianity, a lot of them went on to become Jews. But they're trying to figure out how to follow God. So Paul has an audience of people who are curious, people who are hungry to hear some kind of good news. And then verses 17 through 25 are narration. And this is a format that Paul is going to follow when he preaches. But the narration is, this is what you need to know before I get to my main point. This is your background info. This is what you need to know. And he lays out his case. He goes all the way back into Israel's history and says, God has been faithful all throughout human history. And he recounts in a Cliff's Notes version Israel's history. God did this, and God did this, and God did this. God gave the people the land, and they wanted kings, and then they did this, and this, and this, and this. And he lays it all out to make the argument that all of this stuff that's happened, all of this stuff that you are familiar with, has brought you to this day, right here, right now, for you to make the decision that I'm about to ask you to make. And then in verse 26, he drops his thesis, his point. You are descendants of Abraham's family. And this is the message of salvation that has been sent. His point is that the promise is for you who listen. The promise that God made to Abraham. All the way back in history. That his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky or the grains of sand by the ocean. That promise belongs to each and every person. Paul says before Moses, before there was even an Jewish heritage to speak of, before they thought of themselves as Israel, before any of that, God's plan ultimately all along was for every human being to be part of the family of God. And that time has come. The message of salvation is here. Jesus changes things, and God's grace is for everyone. And then Paul goes on to make his case. Verses 27 through 37, if you go back and review them later, it's the proof. It's the evidence to support his thesis, his argument, his point. Jesus is the proof. Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promise. Jesus changes things. The people didn't get it, but Paul is preaching and saying Jesus is still at work. The one who lived, died, and was resurrected is the one who's the fulfillment of the promise. He says it's not the law, it's not the deeds, it's none of that. It's Jesus. And that prophecy is being fulfilled right now in and among them. And he points to the Psalms to make his case. All of this, he says, was pointing to Jesus. Jesus is the proof that salvation is available to you. God's faithfulness, the promises of God are fulfilled not in a book, not in deeds, not in a magical prayer or ceremony, but in a son. The Son of God is the only way to forgive sin. That's the heart of the message. That's how Jesus changes things, through his death and resurrection. And verses 38 through 41 are Paul's conclusion, his call to action. He's winding it down. He's asking for a decision. He is offering the invitation. What are you going to do with what you've heard? He asked those listening. And he is as blunt to say, to reject Jesus is to act foolishly, for you risk God's judgment if you do. You are choosing judgment for yourself if you reject Christ. This sermon showed Paul's audience and shows us that God fulfills God's promises. And that it's through Jesus who changes things and brings those promises to fulfillment. And Paul spent a lot of time painting a picture of life before Jesus and life after Jesus to show us how Jesus changes things. And he very clearly shows that while nobody, even the prophets, fully understood what God was up to or what God was going to do, that there should be no doubt that this was God's plan. That God has sent his own Son to die on the cross for forgiveness of sins. That through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, things have changed. We can't find forgiveness outside of that, but in that we can find a fresh start. Through the power of Christ, no matter where we're at in life, no matter what we're enduring, no matter how many bad decisions we've made, through Christ, forgiveness, reconciliation, and a fresh start are available. God has done this for us. And because of this, we are able to make a decision to accept his gift of grace and receive his forgiveness. And there's no excuse to remain ignorant of the reality that Jesus changes things, that Jesus can change us. Now, this sermon of Paul's riled up his congregation in both good and bad ways. There were many in the audience, particularly among the God-fearers, the Gentiles, who were asking questions and curious about how to follow God, invited Paul and Barnabas back the next Sabbath. Please come back, y'all. We want to hear more of this. A lot of them wanted to hear more about Jesus. And then, of course, you had those who wanted them to hush altogether and get out of town. So they gathered together again. And Paul and Barnabas heard the opposition, but it didn't stop them. Because they knew there were people hungry to hear the gospel. And they said, this is God's plan. You either accept it or deny it, but the choice is yours. That Jesus is changing things and he can change your life if you'll let him. But if you reject him, that's on you. And a lot of people came to Christ in those moments. But unfortunately, a lot of people chose the other option. But that wasn't God's fault. In Jesus, God swung the doors open wide and offered the Spirit to change each and every individual's life if they would trust Him to do it. Because that's God's plan. God's plan involves inviting all people to be changed. And when we reject that, we are choosing that rejection. The Jewish people are given the first opportunity to respond, but the Gentiles have been part of God's plan all along as well. Each of us in here this morning have been part of God's plan. Paul announces that the invitation to follow Jesus is for all of us, because Jesus has changed things. There's no exclusivism. There's no longer only a certain people that can be welcomed, but all are welcomed and invited to the foot of the cross to die to themselves and to rise from the tomb to life in Christ. In each and every one of us, even if we have made a profession of faith ourselves, we too should be reminded that Jesus changes things. Those things in our life that we need to let go of, that we need to change, those parts about ourselves that keep us from being all that we can be in Christ, Jesus' promise holds true for those things as well. And if we choose to reject Jesus' plan for our life and His ways, then we're only making it hard on ourselves. For we are called to be responsive to the calling of the Spirit, to respond to the tug of Jesus on our lives, lest we fall into the trap of rejecting Jesus and the change that He wants to bring about in our lives, to make them better. So then, church, let us do as many before us have done, and hear the message of the gospel, and let Jesus change us. Amen.
Please stand for our hymn of response. Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, on this beautiful fall day, we ask that your blessings be upon us now and forevermore. We go forth from this blessed place asking that you inspire us to live our lives in a way that will be pleasing to you. Let us love and serve you, rejoicing in the power of your Holy Spirit. May your blessing be upon us and remain with us always. All these things we pray in your name, God, in the name of your Holy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.